Hi, and welcome to the first session of the Essentials of Parsing class. My name is Dmitry Soshnikov, and I'll be teaching this class. And let's start from the agenda, what we'll be studying in this class. Now, this class has two parts. And the first part of this class will be devoted specifically to parsing theory, different algorithms, such as LL, LR parsing, what is left recursion, context-free grammars, what is shift-reduced conflict, etc. And in the second part, which actually will run in parallel, we'll be implementing a full parsing for programming language, very similar to Python or JavaScript. And for those of you who have taken the Essentials of Interpretations class, this will be a front-end for the EVA programming language, which we have built in that interpreters class. We have been using the S-expression format to focus on the interpretation and runtime semantics itself and skip the parsing stage altogether, right? And for runtime semantics, S-expression does exactly the job right. It allows starting and implementing the language itself right away. And why would we need a separate syntax in that case? Well, first of all, it's ergonomics, right? Pretty often users of your language would like to write something which looks similar on the right-hand side, right? So a good syntax of your programming language is also a reason why people would choose to use specifically your programming language. And with this being said, let's get started, and we'll talk about Parsing Pipeline. We have already talked about it in the Essentials of Interpretation, so for those of you who have taken that class, this will be slight repetition, but let's get started. So let's say we have an abstract program which prints the word hello, and the first module which meets your program is known as Tokenizer, right, or lexical analysis. Sometimes this module is called lexer or scanner. And what's the purpose of the tokenizer? As we can see here, we have characters P, R, I, and T, open parentheses, etc. And it's not very convenient to work with individual characters, right? So the purpose of the tokenizer is exactly to group this set of characters and to produce the first intermediate representation known as stream of tokens. And as you can see, token has type and a value. And this value is also called a lexeme. So in this case, we have two tokens, the identifier with the value print and the string token with the value hello. And we should also say that tokenizer doesn't validate whether our program is syntactically valid, right? It might be completely syntactically invalid. As in this case, we have the program, which consists of two tokens, the keyword if and the open parenthesis. And for us, for readers of this code, it's obvious that this code is invalid. But tokenizer will normally be able to obtain two tokens, again, the keyword if and open parenthesis. Now, the module which actually validates whether our program is valid, syntactically valid, is known as parser. And this is exactly the purpose of our class. We'll be focusing specifically on this module, and we'll implement and talk about all the different algorithms used for parsing. And in theory, the purpose of the parser is specifically the validation, that is, whether the string is accepted by your grammar or not. But in practice, parser produces the next intermediate representation, is known as abstract syntax tree, right? Or AST for short. Now, this is a tree representation of our program, and this is something what we can already feed to an interpreter or to virtual machine and to obtain the result. And again, in this class, we will build a parser, which consumes some program in string representation and produces specifically the AST. Okay, so let's take one more example of the AST. X equals 10 times 5 and plus y. So a possible AST for this program might be an assignment operator, which has left-hand side and right-hand side. Right, and on the left-hand side, we see the identifier X. And the right-hand side here is a complex expression itself, right? This is a addition, which has left-hand side, which is multiplication, again, with the left-hand side, 10, and right-hand side, 5, and also the right-hand side for the addition, that is the identifier Y. Okay, so that is the example of the AST. And when we talk about parsers, we differentiate the handwritten parsers and automatically generated parsers. Now, for the handwritten parsers, we mainly have the implementation, which is known as recursive descent. And there are multiple implementations with backtracking, with predictive, Most of them are recursive, that's why it's called recursive descent. But in general, the parsing process can be automated, right? And there are tools which are called parser generators, which can take a grammar of your language and produce a fast, non-recursive, that is table-driven parsers, which can scan in linear time. And as an example, you can take a look at this tool called Syntax, which is language agnostic parser generator. What is language agnostic? It means you can write a grammar once and then produce multiple targets for different languages, for example, JavaScript, Python, Rust, there's a Python integration, Ruby, and many others. And we'll be actively using Syntax tool in this class to build our parser. Okay, so the parsing process relates to text processing, right? Text consists of sentences. Sentences consist of words or tokens like sems. And so this is exactly what we start with. And we'll talk about symbols, alphabets, and languages. Now, first of all, let's talk about alphabet. Usually in parsing process, the alphabet is denoted with the Greek letter sigma. And let's say we have this alphabet consisting of only two characters, A and B. Right? An English alphabet consists of 26 characters. A Russian alphabet consists of 33 characters. In this case, we have only two. So we say that the alphabet is a set of characters. And a language is also a set. But in this case, it's a set of strings consisting of the characters from the alphabet. For example, the language L1 here consists of any possible strings of any length of any permutations from the symbols from this alphabet. And as you can see, we call such languages as infinite, since we can generate, again, all possible permutations. However, we can continue adding some restrictions, for example, the language L2. Specifically, that all the strings in this language should exactly have the length 2. And in this case, the set of strings is actually finite. Now, the main takeaway here, once we start applying restrictions on the language, we form exactly the grammar, right? The grammar is a set of restrictions on top of the alphabet for the specific language. So let's take a look what is the formal grammar. Again, all the languages have grammars, right? There is English grammar, there is again Russian grammar, and programming languages have grammars. Technically, a grammar is a tuple of four elements, N, T, P, S. Let's take a look what it is. On the right-hand side here, we see an example grammar, and let's take a look what specifically each component means here. So the N, which stands for non-terminals, or the variables, defines a set of symbols in our grammar which can hold some value, right? Which can hold either a single letter, a single character, or a subset of other characters. And in this case, we have two variables, the variable S, which is the starting symbol in this grammar, and the variable X, which, as you can see, can be rewritten with the value B. So once again, a variable can be replaced with the values hold. Now, in contrast, the terminals are the actual symbols which appear in our strings, in our programs, as is, right? It's not a special variable, but exactly the specific character. That's why it's called terminal, that is final symbol. And so in this case, we have two terminals, again, the character A and the character B. Now, the P component defines the set of productions, or the rules in this grammar. These are exactly the restrictions or rules which form our language, right? Which specifically tells how the language is structured. And final component in the grammar is the starting symbol. This is just the first production, the first symbol we start our analysis from and start our derivation process. That is the replacing some variables followed by the values they hold. So once again, this is the grammar. And this tuple, NTPS, is enough to describe any complex programming language, context-free, context-sensitive, regular, as we will see shortly. And let's move further. And when we talk about grammars, there is so-called Chomsky grammar hierarchy, right? Defined by the Noam Chomsky, and who made a great contribution to the formal grammars, to programming languages, and natural languages processing. And Chomsky defined this hierarchy consisting of four types of grammars. The unrestricted grammars, that is type 0, are used mainly for natural languages processing. The context-sensitive and mainly context-free are used specifically for parsing programming languages. And the regular grammars are used for parsing regular expressions. To reiterate, in this class we'll be focusing specifically on the context-free grammars. So what is context-free grammar? Why context-free grammar? Well, it turns out the regular expressions which we studied in the automata class are not enough to parse a programming language. The simplest example, right, balanced parentheses, is not possible to parse with classic regular expressions based on the finite automata. Now, on the other hand, the context-free grammar, which is abbreviated as CFG, is trivial here. Let's take a look. So first of all, we replace the inner S by itself. That is again parentheses, S parentheses. Again replace S by itself. Finally, we eliminate the S by the second rule, the symbol called epsilon. And literally it means we can eliminate the symbol altogether. So again, this is a trivial context-free grammar, while it's not possible in regular grammars. And now let's give a formal definition of what a context-free grammar is. Now, first of all, context-free grammar may have only one non-terminal on the left-hand side, right? In this case, we have non-terminal S and non-terminal X on the left-hand side. Now, the second property of a context-free grammar is that left-hand side cannot have any context. What this means, the variable, when it appears on the right-hand side, unconditionally and with no ambiguity defines the specific value it holds, right? There is no X in this context, but when X appears in that context, it means something different. No, when X appears on the right-hand side, it can be written here only with the value B, and it doesn't matter how and when the X appears. And the last property of a context-free grammar, the right-hand side may contain a mix of terminals and non-terminals in any order. Okay, so that's it for today. This is the introductory lecture. That's exactly what we'll be studying in this class. We'll be talking about formal grammars, build parsers, discuss parsing algorithms, and building a parser by itself is a complex engineering task, and implementing it will definitely make you a better engineer. Okay? Thanks, and see you in the class.